morning, everyone. How's everybody doing today? Excellent. Well, I'm excited to be up here. Terry is off with family, enjoying the holidays. And this is a time of year where people are talking and seeing all kinds of things that you don't normally see, except this time of year. People are putting beautiful pine trees in their homes. Their homes are decorated with lights. It's all about family being together, and it's also about baby Jesus. Jesus is a small slice of the story for most of our culture, but the part of the story that they're telling is very small. It's talking about his birth, but the story of Jesus is much, much bigger than that. We know that Jesus came into this world, that he took on flesh, that he lived among us as one of us, but that he also was led to a cross where he died, and 3 days after that, he rose. And the thing that I want to talk to you today about is, why would God take on flesh? Why would Jesus need to come into this world? And there's a simple answer to that question. The simple answer is, Jesus came into this world to become an advocate. 1 John chapter 2 and verses 1 and 2 says this, "My little children, I am writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. He is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world." I am so thankful that Jesus came into this world and took on flesh, because I am so grateful to have an advocate. I would go so far as to say, all of us need to say, thank God we have an advocate. I am thankful that I have an advocate, because through that advocate, I have grace. I have precious promises that God has left for me. And the reason that I am so very, very thankful for these things is because I do not deserve them. I don't deserve them because I am not perfect. I constantly fail. I struggle in my thoughts. I struggle in my actions. And before you start looking at me funny, know that each and every single person in here does too. We all struggle. We all make mistakes as we walk through life. Some of our mistakes are more visible than others. The mistakes of the flesh are easier to spot than the mistakes of the spirit, or the mistakes of the mind, or the mistakes of the heart, or when our inner attitudes are broken. Some of our mistakes are so visible that we gain a reputation. You might even say that we have a bad rap. God views all mistakes the same, though, whether they're on the inside or on the outside, whether they're easily seen or hard to spot. And I think that everyone who has made a bad decision and has gotten a bad reputation, that reputation might not be deserved. I think that you can have a bad reputation from poor decisions you've made and still be a good person. Good people still make bad choices. We don't always walk in the right direction. We don't always do the right thing. But sometimes people only see our bad choices, and that's all they know about us. I want to present to you a case for a young man that I think has a bad reputation. I think that some people have communicated about him very negatively. I think people have been too hard on this young man. They have missed who he really is by listening to the things that have been said about him. Most of you here already know who this young man is. We call him the prodigal son. And that's something that some time today and talk about him and to be his advocate. His story starts in verse 11, and it says this. Jesus continued, "There was a man who had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, 'Father, give me my share of the property that is coming to me.' And he divided his property between them. When some people preach and when some people teach, and when they tell the story of this young man, they call him greedy. And I have a problem with that because I don't think that this young man was greedy. His story is not a rags-to-riches kind of story. This was a young man who was born with a silver spoon in his mouth. He had everything that he wanted and that he needed. There were servants in his father's house that took care of his needs. He wasn't some young man who was trying to get ahead through shady means. He is not here to speak for himself today, though. Now, granted, he is a parable, but for the purposes of this. But I'm here to advocate for him today. The first thing that I want to state is that the prodigal was not greedy. He was just someone who wanted control. He was thirsty for control. He thought that he could do a better job with his possessions than his father could. So he goes to his father and he asks for it. I think most of us can relate to this. When we become teenagers, we want to push that curfew as far as our parents will let us. We want more say in who, when, and where we spend our time. Most of us couldn't wait until we turned 16 to get that independence that comes from being able to drive. Some of us, it was 18 when we had finally been able to make some of those choices ourselves, and when we went off to college and got to truly be our own master. We can relate to this young man because he just wanted control. He wanted to do things his way. And all of us want control in our lives. All of us want a say in what we do. This young man had some good qualities, though. The first thing that I want you to notice is I think that this young man was a man of action. He knew what he wanted, and he went after it. There are a lot of people who know what they want in this world, but they are not willing to risk anything to get it. I can relate to this. When I was younger, I had crushes on beautiful girls, and I was not willing to risk anything to tell them how I felt. And as a result, somebody else dated that girl. Now, granted, I have the best girl ever now with my wife. This young man said to himself, "I am not going to let life pass me by." So he goes to his father and he says to him, "Give me my inheritance." And the father was willing. The father divided up his property, gave the younger son his share, and set aside what was for his older brother. Now, once this young man received his inheritance, he didn't handle it well. Sometimes when we get what we want, we don't handle it well. We bite off more than we can chew. We don't always do what is right with what we have. And as church people, sometimes we can pick on those that struggle in the flesh. When we see people who make very visibly wrong choices, we can look at this young man and we can easily tell that he is making some mistakes. He is making some bad choices. Verse 13 says this. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had and set off for a distant country. And there he squandered his wealth on wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. The squandering that's talked about here, I don't think that was just the young man's wealth that he wasted. I think that this young man spent his integrity. I think that he laid waste to his self-esteem. got rid of what it meant to be a man of God. He wasted that part of himself that allows us to stand up straight and to hold our heads high. He made some bad decisions as he interacted with his world. But haven't we all? He's a lot like you, and he's a lot like me. We have all done things that we are not proud of. We have all done things that make us hang our head in shame. Despite these things, I still like this young man. I think that he has some qualities that all of us need in our lives. This young man wasn't afraid to make a decision. Many of us are frozen with uncertainty at choosing the wrong thing. We live in fear of saying or doing the wrong thing so much so that we don't even go down any path. I see this a lot with teenagers, particularly their senior year. They get what I call the question. What are you going to do after high school? What are you going to major in? What are you going to do now that you are entering the real world? I didn't have a good answer when I was that age. My answers were bizarre. I told people I wanted to be a professional boomer retired. But I don't think I've achieved either of those things. Some teens think that choosing a college major will determine the rest of their life. But that is not how it works. I know there's people in this room who went to college for one thing, and they're doing something completely different that has absolutely nothing to do with that degree. But they build this choice up so big in their mind that they're afraid to make a choice. And we adults do the same thing, too. We tell ourselves, what if I say the wrong thing when someone walks away from God? What will they think of me if I start talking to them about my God and my faith? We build this decision so big that it immobilizes us into inaction, and we do nothing. I also think that this young man wasn't afraid to use what he had. So many of us are scared to use what we have. We have natural talents, abilities, gifts, and blessings from God. And we tell ourselves, I am not preacher material. I couldn't teach a class if I wanted to. I am not a sound leader. Have you heard me sing? We say, I wouldn't even know where to start if I was studying with someone about the struggles in their life. I wouldn't know what to say. I don't want to enable somebody into a sinful behavior, so I will withhold what I have. And we find ourselves never doing anything. This young man was not afraid to use what he had. His story continues on in verse 15. It says this. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one would give him anything. This young man is what I would call at a low point. Some of you know exactly how he felt. Like the conditions of life are picking on you. Like everything is working against you. And what I like about this young man is when he reached the end of his resources, he went out and he got a job. He wasn't afraid to work. And I don't want you to miss this because this is huge. He came from a world of silver spoons, a place where he didn't go without, a place where he didn't know what it was like to go hungry. And yet when he was in a position where his resources had run out and he was unable to sustain his life, he knew that he had to go and do something with his hands. He knew that if you don't work, you might not eat. He didn't worry about what kind of job it was, either. He was willing to do whatever it took. It didn't matter what kind of job it was, because the job wasn't about pursuing his dreams and being satisfied in his work. survival. It was about providing and putting food in his mouth. And this young man finds himself in the mud feeding unclean pigs. Verse 16 says that he longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating. A lot of scholars believe that these pods that are referred to are a fruit that comes from the carbola tree. It's a small bush, and it has these pod or horn-shaped fruit. It's filled with a soft brown pulp and seeds. And these seeds and the pulp is used to make a cocoa or a kind of chocolate that is used to flavor drinks and food. And what they would do is after they took the useful part of this pod, they would then take the husk and they would feed it to the pigs. They would take that thing that was no longer useful for human consumption and give it to the pigs. And that is what this young man is longing to fill his belly with. Sometimes we find ourselves out there in the mud of this life, chasing after the fruit or the things that we think will bring us satisfaction. And when we eventually attain them, we find that they are empty. And that's where this young man is. He's in the mud. He's realized that the things that he's chasing after have left him wanting. And that's when this young man realizes, he recognizes that he didn't belong in the mud. He was built for something greater. Verse 17 puts it this way. When he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's servants have food to spare? And here I am, starving to death. I will set out, and I will go back to my father, and I will say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants.' So he got up, and he went to his father." When this young man came to his senses, he said to himself, "I am better for this. God has created me and called me to be something more." I've heard this said before, and some of you may recognize it. We accept the love that we think that we deserve. This young man did not do that. This young man recognized that he wanted something more than a life in the mud. Another thing that I like about this young man is he picked himself up. He did it himself. He picked himself up and he dusted himself off. No one had to come where he was in the mud and counsel him that there was a better life out there for him. He knew that there was something better because he tapped into an inner part of himself, a part of himself that was created in the very image of God. And when he saw that inside of himself, he recognized that he was meant for more than a life in the mud. When he came to his senses, he said, "I will go back to my father." He recognized that he had made mistakes. And he recognized where he had started making those mistakes, at his father's house when he left. It takes guts to face our mistakes. It takes a lot to pick up our part of the responsibility and why things have gone wrong. And it takes humility, because I think this young man was humble, to go back and to say, "It wasn't our circumstances. It wasn't somebody else's fault. I made the mistake." He also had the humility to recognize that when he went back to his father's house, he didn't expect it to be how it was before. He fully expected when he went back that he would be a servant and that he would be working. That's humility and recognizing his mistake. He saw the hope of something better than a life in the mud. So this young man goes home, and in verse 20 it says this, "But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Quick, bring the best robe, put a ring on his finger, and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let us have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. So they began to celebrate. By the grace of the Father, because of the love that a father has for a child, the father decides to accept him back. The father embraces him, and the father throws a party for his son. The father wanted to celebrate the blessing of having his son back, who should have been dead. And here's where I start to have a problem. This young man comes home, and we've talked about some of his good characteristics. This young man had good characteristics. Doesn't mean he didn't make some terrible decisions, though. But we all have made terrible decisions. The problem they have is with his older brother. Verse 25 says this. Meanwhile, the elder son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. That's an audible dance. I don't know what kind of dance that is, but they are celebrating. So he called one of the servants and asked him what was going on. Your brother has come, he replied, and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound. The elder brother became angry and refused to go in. Instead of being an advocate for his brother, the older brother was a hater. He was in his father's house, but he was filled with hate. His sin isn't obvious like the sin of the younger brother. The fleshly pursuits of the younger brother, you can easily reach out and put your finger on it. But the sin of the older brother is harder to spot because it isn't in his actions. It's in his attitude. He was a hater because he was full of jealousy, envy, and bitterness. He was so upset that he would not even come into the house. Continuing in verse 28, it says, so the father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered his father, look, all these years I've been slaving for you, never disobeying you once. Yet you never gave me a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours, who has squandered your property on prostitutes, comes home, you killed the fattened calf for him. The older brother sat in the house with the father. But he wanted the blessings that the younger brother had. But he would not make a move to get those blessings. The Bible says all the way back in verse 12, when the younger brother came to the father to get his inheritance, that the father divided the property between them. That means that everything in the house was the older brother's, but he never asked to receive a thing. He may have been too nice. He may have been too quiet. He may have been a dreamer and not a mover and shaker. He lived in silence. He said nothing until his brother came home. And then his envy and his jealousy started working until the feelings that he had kept bottled up inside were finally given voice through his anger. In his anger, the brother says that he has a problem with the mercy of his father. Maybe some of you have experienced this before. Maybe you have been blessed by God and you called up your brothers and sisters to celebrate with you, to share in the joy that you have because you have been blessed by God. And they just don't want to celebrate with you. I want to say this. If you are blessed, do not cancel the party because someone doesn't want to come. A As children of God, we have every reason to celebrate. As the church, we should be having the best celebrations. And if someone doesn't want to rejoice with you, learn to rejoice by yourself if you have to. Because there is no party like the party that we do not deserve. Philippians 4:4 says, "Rejoice in the Lord always." Again, I will say it, rejoice. Sometimes we need to stop and evaluate our spirit. We need to think about the thoughts that are going through our head. We need to evaluate our attitudes. We need to ask ourselves, how do I respond when you see a brother or sister blessed by God? When the older brother heard the party for his younger brother, he was disturbed, frustrated, angry, and bitter. He felt violated by the success of someone else. He started comparing himself to his brother, and he said, "I have always been here, obeying, serving, working." He uses the word slaving. He was so upset that he couldn't even go and talk to his father. He stayed outside the house. But I am so glad that we have a father who will come outside the house and meet us on our level. We have a father who will leave the house and seek a lost and upset child. Amen. The problem with the older brother is this. He has become uncommunicative. He has hurt and he has pain that's on the inside. And he's kept it bottled up. He's pretended that everything was okay when everything was not okay. He isn't giving voice to his feelings until it boils over when it's stirred by his anger. And we have people in the church who embrace this kind of behavior, like the older brother. We come to church and people ask us, "How are you?" And we say, "Fine." And we shake their hand. And we smile. We know the right things to say. We know the right things to do. We know the right way to act. But we keep all of that hurt and that pain bottled up on the inside. And that only leads to one place. It leads to a nervous breakdown is where it leads. This kind of behavior leads to a faithful man with a family who takes the trash out one night and never comes home. This is the kind of behavior that takes a submissive, gentle, nice wife, and one day she says, "I am sick and tired of this." It's what makes a minister or an elder after 15 years of serving a church walk away and have nothing to do with the church anymore. And people are caught off guard, and people thought that everything was fine. They said, "But they were so nice. They had no problems. It seemed like everything was fine." It's not always the things that are on the outside that are the problem. It's those things inside that are the problem sometimes. It's the spirit that is not okay. We keep it bottled up. But who can wipe the tear that you will never allow to fall? Who can comfort a cry that you will never give voice? Who can console someone who pretends not to be broken? The older brother had some frustrations on the inside that he never expressed. And we have people here that are wondering, when am I going to be blessed? Why am I still going through this? Why is this still happening in my home? I am trying to follow you, God. I'm trying to do the things that you want to do. And the question is, how can we deal with the things that are happening on the inside? And I think we can learn a little bit by looking at how the father dealt with the older brother. And that's why I am so thankful that we have a father who comes to where the brother is, and he begins to help him understand. Verses 31 and 32 say this, "My son," the father said, "you are always with me, and everything I have is yours." But we had to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead, and he is alive again. He was lost and is found. The problem with the older brother is not his performance. It's not about how often he comes to church or how hard he prays or giving of his means. We, like the older brother, fail to understand that everything he has is ours. The older brother did everything the father asked. He performed all the functions. And here's the difference between the older and the younger brother. The younger brother went to the father and he said, "Give me what you have for me." The younger brother had faith that the father had allotted something for him, and he asked for it. The text tells us that the father had already set aside something for the older brother. He says it here in so many words, "Everything I have is yours." And the older brother failed to communicate with his father. He failed to ask. And he failed to communicate with his brother. Your power to receive the promises of God are not found when you go through empty motions. It comes when you have faith in the promises that the Father has said are already yours. We need to be like the man in Mark chapter 9 who said, "Lord, I believe, but help my unbelief." I identify with both of these young men, and I think so do you. Because at some point in our life, all of us fall short of the glory of God. Thank God we have an advocate. I am so thankful that Jesus is our advocate before the Father because he understands our weakness. He understands our fleshly desires. He understands our attitudes and the brokenness that we keep inside. Satan is an accuser, and he wants you to have death. But Jesus is our advocate, pleading for life, reconciliation, and all of those promises and blessings that we want in our lives. This is why Jesus took on flesh. This is why Jesus came into the world. This is why he lived among us as one of us. I want to encourage you, among all of your celebrating over the next few days, remember to celebrate the fact that you have an advocate. That is why we come here day after day, all year long, and we can celebrate because we can thank God that we have an advocate. I don't know if there's something in this message today that spoke to some brokenness that you have in your life, but there are brothers and sisters here who want to help you start that communication with God again, and we would love to pray with you. So if something in your life needs to reconnect with God, come forward as we stand and as we sing.